for sure need to talk about it.
Wow. That was an entrance.
I love this picture.
Sounds like I'm about to put a gun or something, like the Western.
Yeah.
But it's for sure, Dave, that had a South American vibe, right?
Very much so. It's lovely, yeah.
Yeah.
It's moody and brooding. It's very, very nice. Yeah. Cool.
We are
Andreas,
in
the Marius, Sava, Manfred, Thorsten, Stefan, Hit Wombat, German Roso, Sasha. Nice, nice to see you all. Yeah, that was a start. Thomas, what record?
It's an amazing record from Argentina.
Argentina, okay, cool. Yeah. And is this, you know, those records? Locus here. Hello, Stanti.
Hello, sorry.
No problem. You know, with those records, it's difficult. Is this now a 20 euro record, a 200 euro record, a 2000 euro record, or a 10,000 euro record? It's always so difficult to set, to tell with those. It's almost impossible, right? What kind of record when it comes to the collectability and the price is this?
I've seen it. I think it's up sometimes on Discogs for, I think, between 100 and 300 maybe.
Okay, so doable.
Yeah, it's doable. Yeah.
Nice. Can you give us another impression? Is there a third song where you would say, okay, let's get into it? El Trio Stunt, you're aware of them?
Now, yes.
Okay.
It's last week.
Yeah, it becomes like something from a soundtrack. It has a little bit the Tarantino feeling of the whole album.
Yeah, but still, it's also
funky.
It's
all of those funky elements and slightly jazzy elements, which are very, you know, lean themselves towards the Exotica collectors as well, and the people that like the plates and things. So you can sort of hear the elements in that. Why it's, you know, why it's got a little bit of a price tag, you know, attached to it. It's not a 20 euro record, right? It's a 100, 300 euro record, and it's very cool.
It is.
Yeah, and it has a little bit the same feeling as some of the new trends that's out with the simple guitar, with the Spanish feeling into it.
Joe in the Deadwax asks you, Thomas, are there some sounds, some songs with vocal, or are they all without vocal?
They're all without vocal.
Okay, it's in this one. Okay. Music Hall. Dave, you know this label? Or
I don't know the label. From
Finally, a label you don't know. I love it.
And I like it that it used to belong to Juan Carlos. Which gives it more character, you see. We know. You know, that was a... I just love that sort of thing. Gives it some history, you know. And it's got a great cover, by the way. It's really simple, but the black and white...
Yeah, it's lovely, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah.
Tech,
yeah.
You know. Yeah, I can see. Oh, yeah, I want one myself now.
Dave, Stunty, Thomas, tonight's topic is South America. Thomas seems to be quite deep into this genre. You are more or less an observer, Dave. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, I don't really have it. You know, it's not that I don't like them. It's this. Those are the sort of records you hardly ever see here in the UK.
Brexit.
Yeah. It's the sort of thing. Yeah, and I love it. And I like hearing it. I like, you know, hearing elements of it that are very, you know, there's obviously some amazing records. I've got some friends that are quite into the sort of Brazilian jazz sort of thing, bossa nova records. I know some of those are very expensive, and I've heard some that I like, but you know, they're really obscurities, and you know they're not easy things to get hold of, right? So, but that's why I'm here. You know, I'm here to sit back, open my ears, and hear some great music.
That's the idea. Stunty, South America. What comes in?
Yeah. For me, in my record collecting, it's twofold. I collect all kinds of music, but the music I'm most collecting is avant-garde, modern classical, avant-garde electronics. So of course, the more exotic the origin, the more exciting it is for these records. And I have quite a few. Like I don't try to have everything of that kind, but there, it's not like there's like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these records. There are quite a few, and then there are some folk or Brazilian singers that I really, really, really like. So I looked it up quickly, and I have probably around like 300-400 South American, Central American records. As we have a loose definition of South America today, right?
Yeah, but I think we also keep out Brazil, right, Thomas? Because Brazil is in a way an own topic. Or did we decide we do it today too, but also a similar a single one?
I don't remember
what we said.
I don't think we said anything, but for sure we can make a separate one with only Brazil. But it's fun to hear a little bit about from a lot of countries, right, from South America. So, because Brazil is of course the biggest one, and where you have most hits and songs. Like when you go to the next one I'll play is from Venezuela. It's not like you have hundreds of records from Venezuela that's interesting. Yeah,
of course. But Stunty just gave his approach, that he says that he is very much into modern classical, ambient and avant-garde music. And in a way, in other words, I understand him that way. The more obscure it gets, sometimes it's very attracting. What is your take on the South American music? What fascinates you as on the South American aspect of record collecting?
I think it sits a little bit on you. I've been DJing for many years, so I always want to find tracks that good for playing out and for party, cocktail party, yep, whatever it can, yep, be. That's been my focus for many years. And that's why I want to pay amount of money for a record, if I can use it out and inspire somebody else with those music.
You have another example for us on the record player?
I found one from Venezuela, so we jump a little bit around. So let's take this.
I was just quickly wanting to point out, like as Thomas and Michael were saying, like Brazilian is such a massive portion of that for us Westerners, so much so that if we don't do Brazil today, Dave, how much can you show if we don't do Brazil today?
Me?
Yeah.
Nothing. Well, I do have somewhere hidden away some, you know, some Cuban records and stuff like that. But Stunty, I'm very interested. You know, you talk about electronic music and modern classical. I bet there's some amazing material that comes out of South America.
Yeah, now that Thomas is going to play. Yeah, Venezuela is an important. It will be fun to follow Thomas Venezuela entry.
This was just another one from Argentina we were before, but that's more electronic in the style.
That might be the maddest cover I've ever seen.
And this is not a painting, it's a photo, Dave.
Yeah,
it's actually a real photo of the devil at evil. Yeah,
there's nothing mad about it.
What does that tell you about the music that's going to be on there? It's going to be mental, right?
I can't wait. Well, it tells us that you're a little Christian boy, Dave.
It's boy.
Let's get into the Venezuelan record now, please. I really want to hear it.
You get it here.
Thank you.
Look at the young lady. I promise you. A villa alien.
Baker and Fell Alive. They've copied it off. Now, that's really interesting, that. Great record.
Is it?
Mm.
And I think what Thomas just showed is one of those if I remember correctly, because before we did our last week's work stream, he played that record and said, oh, wow, this is amazing. This is amazing. And but I think this is...
Out that I noticed that record was on Philips. And Philips are a really good label. For recording music in all of these territories, like in Africa, South America. They were so good, they got everywhere. So I just think it's brilliant. Again, you hear that, it's just amazing.
So they had their office in Venezuela, a pressing plant?
They were doing an awful lot of recording in Africa, but obviously they must have had a satellite office doing the same thing in South America. I mean, their tentacles are reaching really far out, you know. Yeah. So I just think, as soon as I saw the Philips logo, I was like, there we go, brilliant.
Amazing. Thomas, what year are we talking here? Roughly. Are we 70s? Are we 80s? Are we
late 70s?
Late 70s.
Yeah.
Wonderful. That was a cool one. Difficult to get, impossible to get, easy to get. You have 25 copies or?
There's two different covers. It also comes with this cover.
Okay.
But they're both pretty rare. I would say maybe €400.
Okay.
What Dave was saying about like the reach of these labels and this music, you just have to remember the famous Muhammad Ali boxing championship in Africa when that kind
the
of
the rumble in the jungle.
Yeah, that's kind of an example of how like. At one point in the 70s, like part of the new countries like Brazil, Congo, like they tried to build like an economic partnership, which was also cultural. So, so that's how like distribution networks that were completely outside of the regular Western ones existed for sure. And, but I have a Venezuelan record on a Venezuelan label, almost private press, which is Grupo Experimental Electroacústico. And you can see here, Caracas.
Oh, also 19. Venezuela. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And this sounds like Drexia from Venezuela, six years before Drexia. Yeah, yeah.
I just love Drexia. So it's like early 80s electro business,
But it's coming from avant-garde, but because they're using sequencers, it gives when it doesn't sound like Drexia exactly, but it's the closest analog I could find that would talk to you. It's more avant-garde, but there is this like cyclical, arranged. I'm forgetting the word, but yeah, you get what I'm saying.
What you mean, yeah.
Like proto Drexian music without Drexia even existing for them. And the composers here, the only one that I know that has done anything elsewhere is Louis Levin. But yeah, always, you know, you find his name, then you look for more stuff. And even if there's nothing, you still look just in case, because these records, this one is kind of well documented, but there's always records that you're discovering. 2 weeks ago, when we were doing our library soundtrack stream, during my last Friday, I played 2 7-inches that I had that I showed that were not on Discogs. I realized.
Question from Liam: Have you, Stanti, or Thomas heard of Chilica Sarabia? Name I've come across a few times regarding Venezuelan music. Are you familiar with her?
Yes, Thomas? But Thomas. Well, I don't have any records, but yeah, it's I actually have some songs, but not on Venezuelan records, on of all places, on Finnish records. Yeah, do you have any, Thomas?
I'm not sure. I don't think I have any of those records. Is it new stuff or old stuff? I'm not sure.
No, it's not new. But the thing is interesting also. There's a lot of South American music we are aware in the West because of its revolutionary roots or nature, like revolutionary songs, protest songs from Chile. It's big. Like, I have a lot. Yeah.
Cuba problem. At some point,
yeah, but like this, for example, this is Guatemala,
yeah,
and this is on Love Records in Finland. Lots of, as you can see, like skeletons.
Well, they have to find a place where they can put out their music, right? Because in their country, it's not possible.
Yeah.
Thomas, we continue the journey.
Yeah, we continue.
Oh, I remember now. You spoke that too before we started. I remember that.
Yeah.
Wonderful. I think we can go on a little bit. The song is amazing and we are not in any danger of...
I don't think.
Wow. Hey, is this cool or is this cool?
No, I like this. It's got a very mellow laid back. I love the jazzy, funky vibe of it. I like the use of the reverb in it. It's just very, very cool, funky. You know, like Thomas says, it's the sort of thing that DJs like to play out because other people don't know what it is. And that's what that's all about. That you play some mad tune that everybody else doesn't know.
What is it?
And that's one of them, right?
It's interesting because it's a good example of Well, obviously you have jazz in the US, in Europe, in Japan, in Africa. You don't have much straight up jazz in South America, because it was, from my experience, I really struggle to find any. There is some, but most of it is because it was immediately amalgamated in other genres that were already coming from roots that were the roots of jazz. So it's kind of like, yeah, non-Western take on jazz that is, you have to, like, there are so many countries in South America where, like, you dance, you have sex, you dance, you drink, you have sex, you dance. That's kind of the three pillars of, like, popular culture. So
how about sex? You didn't mention that, I think.
Yeah. No, but
Stunty's then, just talking about his usual week day by day.
Yeah.
Let's get into some more music now. Cigar. Exactly.
Very cigar. Important, Harry. Let's just go like that.
So, when you now listen, we listened now to, I think, three or four songs from Thomas Stunty. Mm-hmm. You can live with this take from Thomas when it comes to South American music, or is your approach totally different one?
Not necessarily. It's not that there's only one approach that
works. Yeah, of course. But I have to ask you a question. Sorry.
Yeah, no, but it's like Thomas, he said it straight up. Like, all the songs he played so far are coming from a DJ perspective, in a way. It's music that is cool, that has like a groove that you can soft party to so far. I'm sure he has some hard party tunes as well. But, and that goes with what I was like alluding to, that like culture, at least in, since the six, basically since most of this country were under a dictatorship, what did people have left? Like, there was a huge control on culture and all that. So you dance, you party. So music is more hedonistic in those countries. Then it's not because of the nature of the people and because there it's hotter. Maybe it is a little bit of that, but it's also
come on. The weather plays a big, 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 big role. It's different if you are in cold, rainy Düsseldorf or cold, rainy London or freezing Copenhagen or at Cuba. Venezuela. Yeah. It's a big difference. Come on. The weather plays a big role. It might sound silly, but I think the weather.
Yeah, but we had to mention that. Absolutely.
Can you imagine this man in Brazil when it's carnival in Brazil? I can.
I can, but the police is involved in the story.
You know me too well, Stunty.
So that has been the Exciters, right? An amazing record. Which year?
It's I think it's around 74, 75.
Yeah.
It doesn't say anything on Discogs or here. It's from Panama.
Panama, okay.
Really? Wow.
Wow.
That's amazing.
And look at this man. Again, this man beneath me. And his Commonwealth, right? It's all Commonwealth. In a way, tonight, Dave visits the colonies.
I just think it's really that record does excite me.
Yeah, it is, and, isn't it?
You know, it's just something about it. It's just so spot on. You know, and I like the slight. It's the logo of the label that I get as well, with the little star. Right? Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like kind of, it's just got something going on about it completely, that record, but it's so damn funky.
Thomas, is there any chance then that you can make Dave a really, really happy man? Do you have the original inner sleeve with the
No, I'm not kidding. The Panamanian one, Thomas.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Because maybe they have some specific characteristics. You never know. No. Okay. No. Okay.
And remember, we have to mention with these records, sometimes you have to accept some of this writing on the label, the cover, and all that.
Is that quite common for the area?
Well, no. Do you know what it is? It's because these old records, they were played out, and people tended to write their names on labels so they wouldn't get mixed up or lost, or someone else would take them. It's a DJ thing. Or if someone owns a record, they'll sometimes write their name on it. But I think you'll find in this case, it's more when it's on the label like that. So if they're DJing out, they can keep an eye and they know it's their record, right?
Yeah, usually when it's only on the cover, it's coming from a radio or an archive. And when it's also on the label, it's usually a DJ as well, or someone, something akin of that, usually.
How about a simple private person?
No? Why would you do that? But I remember, I have a funny story.
And when I was a young boy, I'm talking now, I'm 10, 11, 12 years old. And my best friend, he had an older brother. He was 3-4 years older. On every record, he wrote his name, painted little flowers. At that time, it was quite common.
Yeah, but there was a huge problem with criminality in Germany as well at the time. People were thieving left and right.
Everywhere.
No, but I remember I had like a British DJ friend who I was working with, and I was the one buying vinyl records, and sometimes we would do... double team. So we would go and rehearse my records in the studio, and without even thinking, he would put a mark on the label. Like it was like a second nature of him. Like, and I was like, dude, like it's my record. Like,
I will do that when next time comes back from Denver. Yeah, yeah. I will write my name. We'll double the value of the record, by the way. Thomas, prepared?
Of course he is.
Prepared.
And the color is not on the big label.
Come again, son.
This can't be on the big label.
Wow.
Is this sound? Wow. All the best possible.
This is one of the most rarest records we have ever shown.
This is amazing.
He made two records. They're pretty rare, both of them. I think when I bought this one 5 years ago, it has never been sold on the internet.
How did you find about it?
Remember? I was buying some records from another DJ. A good friend here, Christian Dior, and he had some special stuff, and this was one of them that got into the pile.
Give us a little bit more, because this is wonderful, I think, and everybody enjoyed it. Country?
It's from Guinea.
Guinea.
Yeah.
Wow. Dave, highlight?
Never seen that, but yeah, it's really cool. I'll tell you what I did notice in it, though. I was listening to the instruments, and she definitely got a hold of Fela Kuti's keyboard, because it's the same sound. So okay. There was obviously like, you know, I just think that's good. They had sort of similar instruments going on, but hey, yeah. I love things like that are just mental, aren't they? You hear those. Never seen
you mentioned
it.
The record 1 year ago or a couple of years ago, never sold on the internet. This is
yeah, well, you know, I like things like that. You know, I've got a term for those, Michael. I call them ghosts. Yeah. And you remember I said that before, because I know about classical like that you know, you don't see. There we got a ghost going on up there, right?
Right.
Well, it is from Guinea, and Guinea is probably the last country you would think of in terms of music industry in America.
I wonder if it was actually pressed there, because, you know, when you get down into these really, really mad, obscure records from particular countries, you know, I just think of things like Malatu Estadke. You know, he's Ethiopian, but most of his records were actually pressed in Greece, because they didn't have the facility at the time to do it in Ethiopia. So it makes me think, I wonder where the record was actually pressed.
You mean a little bit like half of the UK records being pressed at MPO?
Good example, Stunty, yeah. Obviously on a much bigger scale, of course.
I wonder, Dave. I think, Dave, that Stunty had a little clown for breakfast today. What do you think?
He's cheeky, but I like it.
More music.
It's still the same record. Just a little bit under.
Does she sing? Come on.
He's singing as well, yeah. And she, I have a 7-inch that she used an old ice of a label ice, and she just cut it out of on top of another song. I couldn't find it, but I wanted to show you here. So it's like a double single with the old. But this is how she sounds when she's singing.
The instrument sounds pretty, very lo-fi and pretty, and then they double her voice and put reverb on both channels. It sounds like really nice now.
Yeah.
Like total.
But Justin, you also, instead of traveling to Guinea now, maybe just look in the OBC shop for the next days. A lot of those South American records will show up before you drive to Guinea now.
To sound a little bit like it's a Marvin Gaye track that she made into her own style. And come up to me, baby, help me forget this night's blues. Come up to me. But all tracks on the album is interesting. So every track has a little bit speciality.
Nice. And has there ever been a reissue of this specific record? Probably not, right?
Not that I heard of.
Wow.
That's like, if you think like the sound of it, they probably, like the master tapes of that probably don't exist at all. And it sounds pretty rough, but I don't care. It's 100% not an audiophile record, and that's totally fine. It's just great music.
Whatever that means, but sometimes you are surprised of how good they can sound. Because, as I said, Thomas brought some of those records with him when he came to me, and I was sometimes stunned of the overall sound. Wait a second.
Is this label?
Rhythm. Nice.
Like, let's try to have like Riverside.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but this one, honestly, it sounds like the production is super rough, but I don't care, because that's, for me, it's even more special, because that means that you have your ears have to filter out that a little bit to just like discover the actual quality of the music, which is, for me, it's the best. It's my favorite part.
Looking at that label and how sort of textured and rough it was, it almost looks a bit like a Jamaican record in a funny sort of way.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I just like to, you know, it just the way I just like it. You know, I, you know me, the way I am with records. I'm all about the music, and it's not about the audiophile credentials. Yeah,
of course not. But I agree with Marius here. I thought it might only be at my end. There was quite a difference between side A and B when it came to the sound quality. I agree. I had the same effect here. Yeah.
I think I heard that it's recorded in a lot of different places.
Okay.
Yeah, so that might be it. I'll play a little bit more from another track.
Come on, sisters and brothers! Get down! Get down and move! Get down! Everybody! Move me!
Now baby is cutting a bit.
Fighting each order while out there, there's a job to be done. Together we got to reach out and do something good. Forget who's who and join on and do. We got to get on the moon.
Will Nadine have to mortgage her home, Thomas?
Sorry?
Will Nadine have to mortgage her house?
Yeah. I think so.
Was it also the same record, Thomas, or was it a different record?
Same record, yeah.
Wow.
And there's another track that I play all the time. I can't figure out which one it is, but I'll just
give you time. We just give you a minute. Just figure it out. We take the time. Stunty, is this a Stunty record too? Would you be interested in this record?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. You heard, you saw like the first, like when the first track Thomas was playing, like this electric keyboard that was really rough, and then the contrast was like, like this is always interesting. And also when you see the cover, for me, the cover, you see that they try to make it professional, but you can see it's not. You can totally see it's not. Mm-hmm. There's clues. So it's always like, okay, this is interesting. I'm going to check it out. And as Justin was saying, or he checked on Discogs, there's only 43 LPs from Guyana.
43, amazing, huh?
That's so if you found one, you get it.
Yeah, but I agree. But on the other hand, Stunty, I think there are way, way more. They're just not on Discogs.
Yeah, but you know, like a very good point, Michael. At the same time, it would be one of these kind of countries where it's kind of likely that they didn't have that many, because if you know
I don't say they have thousands now, okay, but they will be above 100.
Yeah.
There's probably a pile of records over there in someone's house at the back, you know, just waiting to be found. Yeah.
Dave, do you have the address? Come on, you have the address? Justin Peters will go within 5 minutes. He's in the
place. We're going to help a mission, Mission.
He will be on a mission. Oh, I'm hearing music. Oh, okay, it's through the headphones. Ready? Or shall we?
I couldn't find the track, so I jumped onto the next record. But it's a amazing record to listen to, jump into, because you never know. And check out the other albums she did as well. And she did a few 7 inches, which is worth as well to check out.
So is she an artist that are amongst you DJs is quite famous?
No. It's super obscure.
No, there might be a few in Copenhagen who knows about.
I can tell you, Michael, there's less than 50 people in Europe who knows about that record.
No, it's some more.
Yeah.
We ruined it. Like we always do. I think this is a time. for the beer of the evening, Dave?
I'm thinking,
Dave.
Tiny Rebel, Club Tropicana.
Okay, so are you the Tiny Rebel who drinks Club Tropicana, right?
Tiny Rebel are pretty trendy. They're from Wales. They've got a very cool logo, as you can see there at the bottom. It's like a sort of little bear.
Yeah. Nice one. Yeah, I agree. Nice one.
And they're one of the ones that are sort of they've got a bit bigger now. They're in the supermarkets and everything. So it's a little bit. I prefer to, I like the more obscure side of the beer world. But hey, this is a very, very drinkable beer and very easy to get.
This can look so tiny in your hands.
It's just my hands got really big. No, it's just a little can. Yeah, it's like a standard. It's a 330. Like actually, is it 330 or 2? I don't
okay.
know. It's just a stat like a Coke can, something like that. So
you need anyway. 10 to 15 of those for an evening, right?
Well, for a man of my constitution,
stature,
and I like to enjoy myself, so maybe 15 would be about the right amount. Yeah. Cheers, anyway.
Cheers. Yeah, Thomas. Before we get into the T-shirt of the evening, have you prepared another record for us?
Yeah. I played a record when we talk about the T-shirt.
Exactly.
We jump to another country, to Peru.
Peru. But this is almost, from what we have seen so far, a luxury edition, premium edition, gatefold. Wow.
Yeah. It's really nice.
It's like a professionally printed cover. Nice, lost finish. Very nice.
Ooh.
I need another album.
Thomas, what's the label? I'm curious. The label this song.
I'll show you.
Can you give us more volume, please?
was wonderful.
I was going to say, they look very well pressed as well. Did you see the quote? You know, you can always tell a disc and it just looks really well made in general. Not just the cover, but the disc. So they're obviously doing it very professionally there in Peru.
Yeah.
They must have had a bit of money, yeah? Called the export in Peru, yeah?
By no means I'm an expert on South African music, American music. I know quite a lot of stuff that I'm interested in. What I know is Peru is probably one of the most consistent market for South American music. Like, they have tons of psych rock, folk, funk, avant-garde music. There's even right now a really cool label from Peru called Bru Records that is putting out both new rock, avant-garde, free jazz, weird stuff, and archival stuff. And nice. They have crazy release schedule. Like, it's yeah.
Stunty, do you have an example of Peruvian psych rock for us? Do you have an example?
It's not my specialty. I enjoy listening to it, but I'm not pursuing this. Okay. So I wouldn't be the right person for that.
Okay.
But Peru, yeah, has the... at one point, I think they had at least two pressing plants. I'm more knowledgeable about this kind of stuff. And now I don't think they have any. I think Bru presses in Spain, actually, in Barcelona. But
Can you say again the name of that label you talked about? I think the new...
R-U-H.
Maybe you write it in the chat. That would be best. Thank you. Okay, Thomas, hit us a little bit more with the music. Thomas, do you have by any chance Los Destellos and can make It Wombat at you?
I think I have 10 pallets of records that start with Lost something. I will look it up to see the cover because I can't remember.
You know, when you say 10 pallets of records, everybody would say, oh man, he is overdoing it now. But in your case, this is probably true.
No, we bought a huge collection from Mexico.
Okay.
So we have a lot of Mexican. And when you want to put them up on Discogs, it's when we bought them, it's one out of 10 that you could find on Discogs.
So, see?
So the pallets are still out there. And at some point, we'll try to put them up again, but we found really amazing records.
I can imagine. Stunt, you want to go through those pallets?
Yeah.
Imagine.
I'm in. I'll come and help.
that's a lot of not good records.
Even say. Better, because your bad record might be my treasure.
I think it could be, because you don't know what's on them.
Exactly.
And then you might find one that's
probably amazing records amongst them, right?
Yeah. It's a bit. I'll look for a 7-inch that we found found a pile up, and that was like 300-500 euro record.
Wow.
So sometimes you're lucky to find.
That comment's brilliant, by the way, from Vinyl Piper. Look, the best Peruvian shops in Lima are in a very bad part of town. So you go down there, but you might not come back.
and if you make it, you have probably a wonderful record.
Yeah, if you get out, then you can have the maddest record that you've ever got, and you came away with your life as well.
Yeah. Although those countries have been Commonwealths, Dave, it's not that common that you get those records in Great Britain. You already mentioned it, right? So they don't show up at your turf in a way, right?
They don't really over here, apart from within the circles of the DJs, you know, and we know all know the people, you know, your Giles Petersons of this world and all the gangs, you know, there's tons of them in London that are very serious collectors. So that there is stuff over here, but it doesn't turn up in the field as such, you know. You know, like Thomas says, it's the sort of thing where really you want to be getting a big collection out of some ex-radio station or collector over there that you find, and it's the only way you're really going to get these sort of things, you know.
Mm-hmm. But Chris here, who's Vinyl Piper, if I remember correctly, his wife is from Peru, so he has a big connection there, and he loves that music.
Santi, one thing, Thomas is now playing, I think we get into another record. I would love to, if that's okay with you, if you are prepared for it, that you play one or two tunes for us, what you connect especially. So first we go into Thomas' next record and Stunty prepares something too. For sure, a great sounding record. For sure.
A little bit different.
Yeah. Which country, Thomas?
It's from Trinidad, Tobago.
Trinidad, okay.
And I think a lot of the tracks I have from that from there is more different than anything else from South America. And there's a lot of disco and soul track that you don't see that much in the other countries.
That was wonderful. Can we get back into the song, if possible?
Yeah. I'll try to jump to the next song because that's a song.
No, of course.
But I like this version of it. It's just finish it. I like this.
Rare record or semi rare? Give us a point
here. I think between 100 and 300. How long are you in? It has has like a sweet feeling to it, like a cruising sound to make. I like the feeling. The whole record is pretty nice.
Okay, now, how do they say? I think it's Monty Python, isn't it? And now for something completely different. Oh, first the label, of course. Sorry. Samp Production, Dave. Ever seen that label, bro?
No, I've never seen it before, but again, a lovely label.
With the deep groove, huh? Wonderful.
Groove, yeah, slightly textured in the middle. Again, just really nice.
And look at the spindle hole, Dave. This record is in an amazing shape.
Yeah, Thomas has got a killer there, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Lovely condition. Look at that. Super clean.
It was at least near mint before I got it.
Right on.
Okay, Stanti, what are we into now?
Something for Manfred.
For Manfred? Oh.
So this is a track by Hilda Dionda, so a female composer from Argentina. And
why didn't you just say Italy? That would have been cool.
Yeah, well, and this is from the 70s, so right when right before the dictatorship, or right in between two dictatorships. Okay. This is a rare record, but it's fantastic in my opinion. Of course, it's avant-garde, but you get like instruments, electronic treatments, cello.
This is a rare record, Stanti. Is it a famous record, a well-known record in that scene?
For people who are into that kind of music, deep diggers, that's a grail. Yeah.
Okay.
It became so. I think there was like a bootleg CD reissue of that, and then there are some tracks by her, by Hilary Dionda, who have been reissued in a very cool way, like good archival releases. But and, I mean, just come on, this is a cool record.
it's a wonderful record. I think many people will disagree, but I'm totally into it. Also, the dynamic of it, the spaces where there is no music at all, and then boom, I love it. Of course, I love it. But when did you get it? Is it a ghost, like Dave would say, or is it?
Maybe not completely. It's probably not as rare as the Guyan record that. That was showcased by Thomas, because the record Thomas showed was not a private press, but almost. This was obviously, this is coming from the academy, which is what is fascinating to me. It's not just some guy with too much time and money who had bought synthesizers. No, it's like music that was produced and supported by the academy, the avant-garde academy. So this came out in a framework, because basically this is kind of the Stockhausen of Argentina. But there's very few records that they managed to release back then.
And will you get into this question and give it an answer? Explain, maybe it needs
they to... They are playing, and it's both played and post-produced, because there's an electromagnetic tape. What do you think of that, Thomas?
I love it. I'll be hunting this tonight.
Yeah, and I really appreciate, Santi, the more spectrum we can show and present here. It's not that everybody has to love every record. I mean, hey, showing the spectrum, showing what's possible, showing what's out there, that's the whole idea. And you, great record. Great.
You know, it's funny because I know it's in jest, like Latin music. But listen to two percussions right now. This is not the kind of stuff you would find in European electroacoustic music. So this is Latin music. This is Latin avant-garde electroacoustic music. It's not trying to be, you know, evocative of certain tropes of the music. It's just using what is there in the culture for means that are more global, probably. I would agree with you that. Anyways, we can go on.
Thank you very much. Maybe we took it the second one from you, if possible, if okay with you.
Yeah, sure.
After Thomas, next one.
Now we jump to the total different world. We're still in Trinidad Tobago, but
okay.
this is something different.
In a way, it's not. Talking 80s here or later, or but not much earlier, right? What year are we talking here, roughly?
Yeah, I think 83, I'll guess.
She's got those Santi, sounds going on.
Yeah, but Santi, this is up your alley too, right?
For sure. This is a dance floor record. Yeah. This is something like I would play that, definitely. It's got a house groove, like a tempo. Not groove, but tempo, for sure.
Yeah, when they put out the album, it was not on the album. So, but it's on the reissue. And this is the 12-inch with the B-side, which is like a disco version of the song.
Okay.
So it's a bit different, and it has more beat into it than the original. But it has some nice instruments in
it. It has. That's the journey. That's the journey. Venezuela, Colombia, Neuss. Neuss is the neighbor city of Düsseldorf, by the way. Dave, that song is something for you too, right?
Yeah, I like that. I wanted to ask Thomas, because I like it that he's got the, you know, more like the generic jacket, or as they would say, disco bag, right? I was wondering whether Shadow was the record label, or is that the record label or the name of the artist?
It's the name of the artist.
See, that's interesting, because when you get a sleeve like that, you know, with the cutout, we're getting into the sort of DJ territory where you tend to have the generic record label sleeve with the cutout. But I like it. It's actually the artist's name on there. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Where was it? There was one comment I want to get into. You're right. We don't say this is a Latin stream. This is a South American stream. And what we wanted to show also is the variety and how deep this Latin, not this South American music can go. It's not a Latin stream. If it would be, we would have called it a Latin stream.
I think this is the deepest deep groove I have.
Yeah, you almost can look until the next to the next side.
Going through to the B side, Thomas. Exactly. You keep through. Is that
any deeper? It will be a hole. Yeah.
Okay, the other one is also deep. That's astonishing.
And again, so
it helps together through the paper.
See, look, can you see the way it's textured on the inside of the deep groove? That's a similar characteristic that we've seen on at least three records this evening. So it makes me think these are all getting pressed at the same pressing plant, because that you always get to see that from the same presses. So it's interesting, this. There was somewhere going on there where all these records were getting pressed.
So you mean that there is a big plant where the South American might
get pressed? I always think about where things are going on, where it's happening. So, and I just noticed that three of them have got the same sort of style. So it just makes me think there's a pressing plant somewhere in deeper South America where these records are getting pressed from.
Yeah, maybe one of the narcos, huh?
Hey, it could be.
It could always be.
Michael there would have had the money to be able to support it, yeah?
Exactly.
And probably pay their artists a little bit at the same time.
But again, we have a very deep groove here. Come on.
Yeah.
This is, wow, yeah, look at this. Very interesting. And also, you know, how they cut it. You see, the it's not so accurate. And wow.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Interesting.
This is the most famous label from Trinidad, Tobago.
Kalinda.
Wow.
There's some really nice 7 inches out, and I can't remember the name of it, but I have the 12 inches somewhere here. I only have the reissue. Mm-hmm. It's like maybe 4,000 or 5,000 euro 12 inches on this label. One of the most famous disco tracks from South America. I was looking for it for half an hour here. I couldn't find it, but I'll play it another day. I didn't bring it here. I think it's at home.
Yeah, sorry, Electronic. I thought you were referring to Latin music, this music genre. Okay. Sorry. Stunt. Okay, go on, Thomas. Yeah.
I just said it doesn't look like Latin, this, but it has a Latin jazz feeling to all the tracks, I think.
Maybe you play something of it and then we go back to Stanti. Can you play it quick so that we get an idea?
I can play something with a more jazzy feeling here.
Okay.
From Trinidad.
I love this way to tie. That's very cool. Afro drop sweat. Wow.
Second, I'm back.
It's a very good cover as well, that. I love the compact stereo.
A pretty crazy cover as well.
Yeah, it's really good, that one.
Yeah, but so much information on the cover. You know, when they do that, you have the technical information, the label, the name, the artist name, and some more, and some crazy visual like that. Like, that's what I call too much information. But at the same time, it probably means like they didn't know what they were totally doing. So it means it's coming from like a a genuine place as well. Like, they're not professionals in the best sense.
Swahili.
Swahili is the song.
That's the core of it, Marius. Give us a little more volume. This is really cool.
I think it's ending now. But...
Ah, okay. Sorry. Have I been away that long? Okay. Have you shared all the necessary information about the record while I was gone, or is there something you need to add?
Everybody's happy.
Everybody's happy. Okay, so no complaints.
We had never had so much happy people.
Especially when I'm gone for a minute. Yeah. Stanti, have you prepared a second record for us?
I have prepared a bunch. And last time after the stream, when you announced to Dave and me that we were going to talk about America.
Yeah.
I was mentioning a record that is not from South America, even if the singer is like probably the biggest singer from South America. And yeah, I wanted to play that because it bridges with other topics we've talked about, other streams we've had, and it's in my top 10 favorite records all genre ever. And it's still kind of affordable record, but maybe not for long. So,
non è più carnevale, ciascuno ha la vita normale, sta ritornando, lei no, lei sta ballando.
So as you can hear, this is not in Portuguese, this is Italian, but this is Chico Buarque.
Oggi mercoledì, nelle strade del centro,
Chico Buarque and Ennio Morricone.
Okay.
This was recorded when the Brazilian dictator made it impossible for Chico Buarque to stay in Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
And he went to Italy and he was supposed to record this record in Portuguese. But if we go a little further, and I wish we do, when we get to the part where the chorists are actually singing, he noticed they were good, but they were better in Italian, obviously. And he thought, oh, I am actually pretty good at Italian too. So you get the best Brazilian singer singing in the most beautiful language, Italian in my
opinion. Nice one.
And this is the name of the album is a play on, you know, for a fistful of dollar, per una pugno, for a fistful of samba.
Okay. Where he probably made the music for, right? It's full of colors, it's probably Morricone.
You get the samba and you get a new Morricone.
Nice one, beautiful.
I thought it would like a soft introduction to Brazil now for Thomas.
I think that was an easier
it was a record that is easier to approach than the first one. An interesting take. And what it makes so special to you is the combination of those two artists, if I understood you.
Yeah, right. You get this melancholy.
Senses that came to be. And okay. Mm-hmm.
Cool. Yeah, because Chico Buarque, usually you hear him like, he's probably the biggest Brazilian singer. Que sera, que sera, which he did like this famous version with Milton Nascimento. And it just gives like other tracks on that record are a little more cheerful, and some are even more like, you know, with a deep Morricone organ, like dramatic, very dark but like sad at the same time, but also melancholic. And it suits his voice so well. And I think also just because of the reason why he was in Italy, as a lot of musicians in the 70s from Argentina, Chile, Brazil, like that was a dark time. So there was always during the 20th century a huge diaspora of artists from South America, especially in France, Italy, and Spain. Spain a little less because of Franco, but still. Franco,
From Regen also.
Yeah. It's something that it's just a way also for us to find other bridges to connect all this to more familiar stuff if it needs.
Thomas, I can imagine that was also a record you quite liked, was it?
Yeah, I love this style. I don't have that one, so another one. I need it.
But Santi said it's not impossible to get, so. Might not
so far, but it was, you know, it was on RCA Italy, so that it was reissued officially for the first time 2 years ago. But yeah, you want the original. I've listened to the reissue and it's good, but like the original is better. There's also Spanish pressing where they actually sing in Portuguese.
Okay,
but it's not as good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. Thomas, where will you take us now? Now we're come into the t-shirt of the evening.
Yeah.
Aya Ehoy, Con Raniel.
I think it means today or tomorrow. Uh-huh. Something like that. And it's one of my favorite records from Peru.
It's one of your favorite records from Peru, or one of your favorite records?
Just one of my favorite records. In this style, it's my favorite record. But this guy, he did a lot of really, really good records. So I'm trying to collect more of them. But I just love this.
Before we get into this grail, Dave, give us a take on the jacket you just see, Dave.
Well, I love it. It reminds me of, it just reminds me of the style of a Jamaican silk screen. Mm. You know, it's got that classic sort of look about it. And you can just see the makeup of it. It's very simple. It's not trying to say anything too much. But it's just very, very, you know, sometimes it's the simplicity of things which make them beautiful. And that's a prime example of that.
It literally looks like a library soundtrack on both sides.
Right. You know. Yeah, it is lovely. Lovely.
Sorry, I interrupted you. Sorry.
Go on.
When I bought it, it was a sealed copy. But you can see, like, when I took the sealing off to open it, it's been in a bad shape for many, many years. But it was...
Yeah.
But to find this record with a cover is nearly impossible.
Wow! So you may just show us the best condition this record exists on this planet.
Maybe I can. I just looked it up on Discogs. I can see there's one for sale without a cover, but it says it's near mint. But it's a near mint from Peru, so. Mm-hmm.
How much do they want for the jacket without the cover?
Without the cover, they want 1,499.
So with the cover, it's at least 1,600.
No, that's only the cover. Without the record.
Without the record.
No, but it's been sold for around 300 euro. So, but
I'm afraid those times are over. 300, I buy it.
But I'll play. It's a different style than we have heard yet. I have a lot of records from Colombia with this style. It's Gambia. But Gambia. I love it when it's played like this. I'll play some here.
Yeah. Yeah, it does play.
Albums. If you like the style, you can put the whole album on. You won't get bored. It's all tracks on the album. It's really good.
Wow! Give us more, please. Give us a little.
By far, since we've started doing this, this is my favorite records that Thomas has been playing.
It's wonderful, isn't it? Can you, Santi? Can you get a bit into this cumbia style? Can you say something about it? Can you explain a little bit?
The thing is that it's like most folk music that now, like when you say cumbia now, it means something quite different from what we've just heard, and it's fine. Like it's just popular dance music, party music that, and there's a tempo, a groove, a certain groove that you could hear there. But in that record, it was so stripped down. That like you had like this guitar and this like keyboard like taking like really popping out on it in a wonderful way, but then you had like the percussion that was playing the cumbia groove so raw that now you get it in a way, like if I guess that people who have heard modern cumbia of recent and who thought, oh, this is disgusting, and they hear that oh, this is amazing, and it's the same. Mm-hmm. It's just that you have to sometimes accept that sound changes, and yeah. Mm.
Give us a little bit more, Thomas. Do you? Without the cover.
Dave, what do you say?
Well, you know what it is? It's with records like that. Again, I just refer to the simplicity of it, which makes it so amazing. Both in the cover, in the music, and it's just, you know, it's a very special artifact. It's a very special thing. And it's very rare. And, you know, you put it on and it's gonna engage you, isn't it?
So if you would have this one in your collection too, it doesn't matter that you're not so deep into that style, right? To having this record is just
wonderful. I would enjoy it every time I put it on. And it'd be, you know, and I'd enjoy putting it on for special moments, playing it to other, you know, it's just a very beautiful record, you know? And that's what's great about this, is finding these obscure gems, you know, not the artist, not totally not obvious, but just totally amazing. Yeah. And there's, you know, this is the journey we're all on.
Right.
What's really appealing to me is that you got all these like melodies that are easy to embrace, to enjoy, but it's also very quirky music.
Mm-hmm.
Like the guitar, dun, 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 dun. Just the context of it around it makes it like the turn now. Oh yeah, this is quirky music in all the best sense, in my opinion.
I'm not sure, Joe and the Deadbacks, that the primary demand is from the country themselves. I'm not sure. I think there are quite some collectors, and I think Dave already mentioned it, that they're also in Great Britain. There are hardcore collectors who are very, very deep into those records.
Into this style, I mean, it's a big area, particularly here in London, you know, and there are people that will open their wallets up to get hold of records like that.
Sure, but like Joe, I think is still correct, because there are so many online marketplaces that are exclusive to South America that if you are not there, if you don't speak Spanish or Portuguese, you wouldn't even be aware of these. And that's how I think there's quite some truth in what Joe is saying. Like the friends I have that are really into like South American psych rock, they know stuff that is like they take for granted that we have no clue of, or some of it emerges, but like it takes so much time before like something that is a classic there becomes a classic for us. If it's an underground record, it's still like we still have like a delay.
Mm-hmm. Of course we have. Of course. I hear singing now.
Same record. It's an amazing record. But if you want to dig into it, there's a compilation that is made that you can get for 30, 40 euro, I think.
Nice.
There's a few of them.
This is again one of those genres. I mean, if you want to get into it and get an idea, the compilation again probably is a very, very good entry.
Then I have a perfect record queued for you.
Okay.
We can listen to this more, actually.
Okay.
I think it's an amazing album. I really love this.
Stanti, what do you have up your sleeves?
Something a little bit special, not expensive, and a good introduction to a lot of stuff then, hopefully. All right.
Okay.
Oops. Oh, sorry.
No problem.
So this is Doris Monterey. Monteros.
Que esta vida é dose braliana. Mas esqueça essa amargura, que essa dor a gente cura.
Are we back in Brazil again, or where?
This is on, as you can see, Odeon, which is the biggest label in Brazil. The compilation from 72.
Yeah.
Previewing upcoming albums from the label.
Okay, nice.
And this album from Doris Monteiro, there's only one pressing, one Brazilian pressing. You can still find for it for like about $30 in good shape. But this compilation is introducing you to a lot of stuff that was not yet classic or whatever. This is just wonderful. The turns.
Que esta vida era dose italiana. Mas esquece essa amargura.
Just an example to show that there's some affordable, great music that also doesn't have 1,000 pressings.
Yeah. So true. Foi-se embora, meu irmão.
Se conforme ela não volta mais. Ela só queria ouro.
Doris Monteiro, just for a little context, she was an actress. She died last year, and she had like 15-20 albums. She was very popular, but never outside of Brazil.
Okay.
But when you listen to it, it's obvious that...
Maybe she should have done a record with Stan Getz then.
Yeah. Well, that shows you that at one point there were only a few spots in the Western world for these voices. Some were chosen, others had as much talent, but yeah.
Exactly. You have to be at the right place at the right time.
Yeah. Or you have to do Beatles covers.
Stumpy, I just want to mention, you mentioned the Odeon label, and that's on. Again, you're saying it was the biggest label in Brazil, but Odeon had a very big reach. It's interesting. In France, in Germany, yeah. Now, and I know this from the classical side of things, but also EMI used the Odeon brand as for their export records. They're selling in other territories. But obviously, Odeon had a very broad covering. Yeah, so it's interesting to see this from Brazil on that label with that classic logo. It's a label that I love, you know.
Oh, yeah. I would say the biggest label in Brazil is Odeon, and the biggest like international label would be Philips. Philips had doing all kinds of music. You have like...
Yeah, and they were making sure they were getting into these regions, you see. That's what I think is brilliant.
Yeah.
You know.
This is Brazilian modern classical avant-garde. Brazilian pressing only.
Right.
70s, 80s, something?
70s, 72. Mm-hmm.
Thomas is prepared, I think, for another record.
I just heard you talked about Brazil and Odeon.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of my favorite albums. The whole album is good as well here.
Mm-hmm.
a natureza morta. Ai, ai, meu Deus do céu, quanto eu sofri ao ver a natureza morta. Vi a mandioca pra farinha e o milho pra galinha.
Let's start at the beginning of our show. He said, yeah, those are not audio file records. But Santi, I bet again, once more, I bet my right ball that this record sounds fantastic. I'm sure it does.
Sure, absolutely. Especially if you have an original.
Exactly.
No, but you can hear on this, like an audio file record for me is not necessarily about the pressing, but about like the recording.
The recording
from Guyana was very poor in many ways. It doesn't mean that it was bad music, but this one, obviously the recording is much, like they had an arranger.
I get your point as well as you get my point, of course. Yeah. But this is an example of a record where I'm sure it sounds amazing if you put it on.
It does, yeah.
Hilário, ai, onde eu bicho terei minha horta. Ai, ai, meu Deus do céu, quanto eu sofri ao ver a natureza morta. Ai, ai, meu Deus do céu, quanto eu sofri ao ver a natureza morta. Ai, ai, meu Deus do céu, quanto eu sofri ao ver a natureza morta.
Nice one. Have you been aware of this record, or is this again a new one for you?
No, this one I know, yeah.
Okay.
I don't have it, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm not surprised that you don't have it. Not surprised in this case. I don't say that you don't like it, but I think this is not a record you will go barefoot to Rome, right? Okay, I think... Do you have anything prepared for us, Santi, or shall we?
No, I don't right now. But,
okay.
I can easily.
Desespero é contra a calma, é, e sem tempo.
The Santi now is the problem. I think it's Santi now, right? That's Thomas. Sorry. Wonderful second. Wow. Wonderful.
Negro é o som de alegria. Nega que ama de dia. Por isso eu sou.
But Brazilian, I just speculate, I'm quite sure we are listening still to Brazilian records, right? But they, I think Trinidad and Tobago and Brazil. Very specific way of music, or is it a coincidence that you choose those kind of records? Because the Argentinian, the Peruvian have been quite different.
I'll tell you my feelings from listening to all this. You can definitely hear the sort of cultural differences within these different countries, but it's also the elements of the traditional and folk side coming through. Or make, you know, traditional music, but coming through into sort of the styles of these, and then the sort of funkier elements, the drums, keyboards, that type of thing. But I just find it's so interesting.
Yeah.
These little subtle differences between them. Yeah, yeah.
A lot of people are asking for more of it, Thomas. Can you give us a little more from that record?
Parado na nevega,
cocô na pele, é PMP, CDP, apa, é cor de meia, noite meia. É luxo pro seu homem só. Neguinha, quero bola, neguinha, quero um bode. Tu é o era de tu viva e tu me come. Vai é pro dado, tombado, 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 quero bola, quero
bola. Vamos, this rare record, an easy to get record. Will we see it at the OBC shop?
No.
Okay. Okay. No. Once more. No. Yes. No.
Now we've got to go back to the questions and put the answer there.
Exactly. Can you be a little more easy with me? With the answers. Tough to get one. It's a very rare record. Easy to get. Difficult to get.
Difficult to get, I think. Okay. I don't know the price on it. It's maybe 500, 600.
See, hey, Joe. Yeah, he lost me too. So we won't see this specific one at the OBC. But every record on the wall we will, for example, see at the
I'll put it up again for a few days. So if somebody really, really wants it.
Yeah, Yeah. Tempting. This is really, really tempting. Okay, you put it up. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Look at the jacket, Dave.
Yeah, it looks like one of those. Again, it's one of those it's one of those records. The cover looks sort of fragile. And just to get one, you know, these Brazilian, the same with the African records. Condition grades are different here. You know, just to get a cover is an amazing thing.
Yeah. So
to get one you can actually, is actually, you know, not missing half of it. Is this impossible thing, you know?
I know it sounds so strange when you start this, but that's so true. I've seen those where you get an idea, you get an idea that there has been a jacket, right?
It's the same thing. If the same thing happens, it's like we should almost have a different grading scale going. Well, we do, but you know, it's so strange that it's just with these records where it becomes, it's like that. You know, Ranil record, you know, to have a cover is something impossible, right?
Right.
Covers, damn. I love covers.
Who doesn't? Stanty, do you love covers?
I do, and I have a great cover line queued up that I wouldn't be shocked if Thomas didn't have a few copies that he could put on the website. So let's see. Thomas, do you have this for sale?
Oh,
wonderful jacket again. Wow.
Se não
me engano, Odeon.
Sei de onde veio você, por onde andou você. Sei que chegou sorrindo, atravessando.
The record you could find for 20, 25 bucks only like a few years ago. Less so now, but.
Se não me engano,
but like just for the water.
E foi pra ser feliz, querendo que eu já quis.
This one you can hear, they know how to record it.
De tudo que existe por aqui. Fale seu nome, a sua idade.
See, again, this kind of little bit of a quirkiness to the music that is very common in... This is a MPB. Música popular brasileira, basically song based, yes. Not song writer, but like pop music. See, Michael, did you see Manfred's comment?
Ah, see, Manfred has it. Manfred has a Stanty record. No, Stanty, no, wrong. Stanty has a Manfred record.
Moça,
Have you noticed? Gone to his cabinet.
That means something serious.
He's trying to find. Look.
Nice one. Very nice one.
And great cover.
And great cover, without any doubt. And I guess Thomas has 20 copies of it. He just doesn't know it.
It's possible.
For the first time this evening, Santi, we will have an armful of records from Thomas.
It's just one of my favorite Brazilian artists that is worth digging into. But I don't know if I should play some at the same time.
Why not?
Up founder.
Why not? So far, we have been quite lucky. Thomas, have you seen that Dave is now trying on our Sunday stream sometimes the Thomas Busk armful of records, and he fails miserably so far.
Now, Michael, you say that, but my eyes are always watching, and I spotted some techniques that.
Yeah, I can imagine. One day you will be perfect.
I'm keeping really quiet, and then suddenly you're just going to see it. Yeah. Seriously.
I know.
It's not like I've not been thinking. I've been watching very closely. And I've seen that there was something I was doing wrong, and I spotted it. In fact, Michael, I spotted it last week.
Yes. Okay.
That's why. So don't worry.
Although you already improved.
I'm here but to learn.
That was a humble version of Dave. You don't see that this often. Still waiting.
I'm ready.
Oh, you're ready. We are also ready when you are.
And I love this track, so I just needed to find the right one. The whole album is good on this one. Here we go.
I don't know about that cover.
It's amazing.
I have this one.
You have it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a classic, that one. Okay.
Music was wow.
Dance record. It's the album I play mostly from him.
Okay, please give me. I am not aware of this guy. I admit this. Dave, are you
Michael? I reckon maybe that's how you sort of looked in your 20s, like on that cover. Similar sort of.
I didn't look last year like that.
That's how Rudy Voller looked like in the.
Okay, Santi, help us. Help me out here. I seem to be the only one who doesn't know this guy.
No, Dave doesn't know him. Or does he?
No, I don't. Santi, I'll be honest. I don't. So, again, it's...
Thank you for the honesty, but I'm not alone yet. Give us some facts.
Well, Marcus Valle, he had like a very... As you can see, he had a long career, and he went
through different optical styles.
Yeah, he's what you call the survivor.
Okay.
I don't know. He's kind of like a quirky Brian Wilson. I don't know how to describe him. I don't know all his records. I know he had like several careers, and. Yeah, you know, it's one of these guys who has his own world and independence and could do whatever he wanted in a way. And
Brazilian Liberace? No.
Brian Wilson or Dennis Wilson. Dennis Wilson.
Dennis Wilson, okay. But the record we
not
just...
Not musically,
listened,
yeah.
Of course. But what we just listened to was amazing, in my opinion. Thomas, tell us your story about this man.
I tried to put this one on a big commercial that I did, but they said it sounded more like music from a porn movie.
Which, yeah.
But I think
which
it was
often
like,
which often is nowadays the best music that's out there.
Yeah, it was from this. I played this track for them.
Okay.
Diga sim pra mim primeiro, diga sim, eu vi primeiro, diga sim de corpo inteiro, diga sim, mas é mentira, tchu-tchu, é mentira.
Yeah. Make porn great again.
Yeah, yeah.
Eu não quero ter ciúmes, eu não quero ter queixumes, quero.
Can you put up some of his records on the LBC shop, because I want those. So this is amazing. Or you don't have spare copy?
I might have a second issue. This, I think the one I'm playing now. So I have a first issue. I'll take this to you. But it's not an easy record to find it. I think it's over 800 maybe.
Wow. Okay.
But I have two copies of this one.
Because the jacket alone is worth the money. I don't know what it costs, but this is wow.
It's a great jacket. Look at the range of cocktails he's got in front of
exactly,
him.
Exactly. Yeah, maybe in the collector's edition there is a sheet with the recipes of them.
Yeah. I'll play a little on that one.
Yeah, please.
I like his instrument. It's all very positive, I have to say.
He was somewhat of a classic on the CBS radio show in Amsterdam. Like basically cosmic disco.
Tem que correr, tem que suar, tem que malhar. Musculação, respiração, ar do pulmão.
Stupid question, important question.
Tem que esticar, tem que dobrar, tem que encaixar.
Always his ups and downs.
Sorry?
Successful artist in Brazil or a lot of...
I think he's one of the most famous artists in Brazil.
Yeah. Okay.
I think all Brazilians will know him.
Okay.
100% sure.
I have to send it to you, Thomas. I did an edit of that song, actually.
You did?
Like with added 303.
I would like to hear that because it has a breaks later into it that I really love.
Yeah, I'll
tune it up when it comes in. But it's
wonderful.
vamos lá, tem que malhar.
Vamos lá.
Musculação, respiração, ar no pulmão.
Vamos lá.
Tem que esticar, tem que dobrar, tem que encaixar.
Vamos lá.
Um, dois e três.
I think I'll jump to the break.
Yeah, it's a long song.
Tem que correr, tem que malhar, musculação, respiração, tem que esticar, tem que encaixar. Um, dois e três, é sem parar. Tem que correr, tem que suar. Musculação.
I haven't been there yet. It's a long track. It's always a success playing this one out. I think it has a good feeling to it when you.
For sure. A lot of those records we have listened today has a very, very good vibe.
It's the kind of music for, like, you know, someone is getting lucky tonight.
Yeah. Oh, many times, lucky.
Vamos lá, vamos lá, vamos nessa aí, não pode parar. Todo mundo junto, ritmo. Tem que suar, vamos nessa.
When is that from? 83? 83, 84, 82?
It's not cocaine.
Wait.
Oh, Colombia.
Keep looking, keep looking, Thomas.
I can't find it. It's always a mess in here. I found the other cubby. That might have slipped.
Two hours, gentlemen. Mm. Flew by once more. Wow. You have another one for us?
Yeah, yeah. This one, I think we promised a little bit of Latin, but I'll play one of my favorite Latin songs that is recorded in America, but it's a Brazilian artist.
Pagabas tú la taquilla y con tu jeva subía después para gozar de lo bueno con la música popular. Y como esas bandas grandes me ponían a vacilar. Pero dime tú, ¿qué es lo que pasó? Yo quiero saber por qué se acabó. Pero dime tú, ¿qué es lo que pasó? Yo quiero saber por qué se acabó.
They didn't send that out in Denmark to DJs.
They didn't.
But it has a really jazzy feeling to it. You hear the louder saxophone going up. It's amazing.
This record is $1,800. Wow.
No, it's not easy to find.
Sounds like it.
But but it also it's one of the it sound amazing. It's well recorded, and it's the whole album is really, really good. It's, I never get tired of this record.
It's a pleasure.
It's a very, very cool record, that one, I have to say. Very cool. Yeah, it's got a real I like the tempo of it and everything as well, you know.
And you know, it lacks, you know, it in my opinion, what I find striking is it has a certain roughness and lacks this total sweetness. There is punch behind the voice.
Oh yeah, very much so. Right? Yeah. I noticed Thomas, it said the label, what was it, Mardi Gras, the label?
Yeah.
Yeah, very, very cool.
But it looks like a $1 record, so it's one of those you can be you can find because it looks like nothing.
Yeah, and you know, but when somebody gets new into records nowadays and says, "Oh, I like it. What do you want for this record?" and say it's 1,800, he says, "Ah, okay."
I'll show you something. Just talk a little bit. Well, this
of course. Music. Hey. Surprising great and very, very large variety tonight, right?
Oh, massive, yeah. It's beautiful to hear. You know, this is a real trip around the continent, shall we say. So,
really
amazing
nice.
Records. Really I've heard so many things I've never heard before. And all great music. All very, I'll say as well, this the general theme, all very, very positive as well. Really, mm-hmm. really great vibe. So, yeah.
If you're interested, I have a... Yeah? Yeah, I have queued up like what I consider a real audiophile Brazilian record from like 1980, I think. And it's going more into a little bit different. We're going back to my first record a little bit. But okay. Again, a woman. Like, recording is insane. The mix... And the soundscape, as people say, is just...
Thank you. Ah, it's on this... what's the label's name? They put out amazing stuff.
I don't know.
Okay. Because the Parmigiani Records looks a little...
Oh, bit, yeah.
You know what I mean?
I know what you mean, yeah. Yeah. Well, she's had a year or two ago, there was a new record from her, Brazilian pressing as well. So, also interesting. And this is considered as a landmark recording and release in South American avant-garde music.
Nice. Is it field recording and stuff like that, or what?
It's electronic, live electronic music, instruments, voice performance.
Okay. But a live performance, and the record was recorded.
So yeah, it's here you have Lato B, the instrumentation.
Mm-hmm.
In the Brazilian, and that's a record I got maybe 20 years ago.
Okay.
Even 20 years ago, it was difficult to get and not cheap, especially for the money I had 20 years ago. But it's really rare. Like, you'd have to pay, but it's still avant-garde music, so it's not going to be like 2,000 euros. It's going to be 200, 300. But the sound is, I don't know how it sounds for you through the whole.
Yeah, of course. That's not the idea, of course. No problem. But we get an idea about the music. That's what we want.
But also, again, she did quite a few recordings and performances. So she was not completely obscure in Brazil, Josi de Oliveira. It's just interesting to me also that music was part of the culture locally, because when you listen to the whole of it, it sounds nothing like French, German tradition of electroacoustic music. There is something really, yeah, from the South. And you hear the double bass here.
I've got to say, it really just shows the broad range and spectrum of styles. Just hearing this compared to what we've been listening to, you know,
yeah.
So culturally rich, you know, the experimentation, you know, wow, pretty mind blowing. Well, a couple of dogs have gone under the sofa, I've seen, but anyway.
You have to live with those jokes when it comes to it. Okay, that's no problem.
I'm used to that.
No, but brilliant. It's just important that, you know, we're showing such a range here. So.
Yeah, and that's
yeah. We're not showing everything because none of them are like
not possible.
Global. Because how could we? We're not talking about music genre or scene. We're talking about a whole continent and 75 years of recordings and releases. So
exactly.
So I guess we have an OBC perspective here, which is probably not the one that most people would have if they did the same thing we did. Because the obvious way to go with South American music would be like Brazilian pop music and or song folk, psych rock, and yeah, like more Latin music. But there's more to that because, I mean, if we go further, like closer to us in time, you'd have like the music that Diplo is popular for. A lot of his music is coming from the favelas of the 2005s and stuff like that. So there's always something happening.
Thomas, you have prepared something for us also?
Yeah, I think I have two albums. One of my favorite albums from Colombia. But first, I will take you to Peru again.
Okay.
Oh, or maybe it was Venezuela. I can't remember. But I think this one could be from a Tarantino movie as well. I love this track.
That's amazing. Didn't somebody ask for the Lost Boys Palace earlier on?
Maybe that was the one.
Yeah, that is the one. The Hit Wombat. Yeah, see, I remember. Yeah, the Hit Wombat. Here it is.
Of course, I have it.
After viewers waited so long for this, now we have to give them. Let it run because they waited so long for it. We go through this talk. Go. Thomas, tell us about this record, please.
I can tell you that it's one of those where it's just a bended piece of paper. It's not a real cover, so that's how they made it. It's
difficult to find with a decent cover, Thomas, right? Because normally it's ripped to pieces. Difficult to find with a decent cover because normally it's ripped to pieces. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. So, but I always want to tear this off, but I think it's It's leave all this together inside. It's difficult to take that off without.
Is this again one of those grails when it comes to the original first pressing in a good condition?
I think you can get it for around 100. It's not impossible to find.
Nice, that's good.
But you will always buy it from South America, yeah. So the condition might not be like you.
I think
this one was an excellent, but I think it. It sounds okay, but it is like a G+ record.
Okay.
Yeah. But it plays fine. It's a good recording. It's
again, Manfred knows this record, okay, and the band. Chapeau. Can you give us a little bit more of it? So many people waited for this.
It's just ending now, but you can.
We have a second song. Maybe the second song is good too. Vantage cover. Good example. That's for this kind of jacket. Vantage.
Thanks.
But still, my favorite album of the evening was this Cumbia record from it. I love that record. That was wonderful.
The Cumbia, yeah. I think
that was wonderful. But it's similar in a way. Yeah.
Yeah. It also they call it Cumbia on the back of the sleeve here.
Okay.
You see the. Cumbia.
There it is. Yeah. Right. Yeah,
it's like a library record again.
It's true.
Yeah. Good. Good plus.
Then they got Taniguchi's team.
Look at the dresser. Look at the guitar. Piero al Blanco.
Yeah, and I think Tarantino actually used a track from this album.
Ah, okay.
I'll just find it.
Okay.
Because it. This is the one I think. This one he used, Tarantino.
Okay. Oh, bye-bye. There's a mythological cover of that is awesome.
If you like the artwork, so this the band is called Afro Sound.
Okay. But how can you not love the artwork?
But it's
another amazing artwork.
He's famous for doing those artworks here. So every time they put out a record with the Afro Sound, it has a nearly naked woman. But when they put out, he has, I think I showed you last time, he has this band together with this
We
band.
Have seen that, yeah, not last time.
But have you seen, I showed this one as well.
I don't think so. I remember the other one, but I don't remember this one.
I think that they enjoy doing the artwork of the
wonderful
of the covers.
Truco El Bueno.
Yeah, and I think if you look at the label, it's the biggest label in Colombia.
Okay.
There's more than 1,000 releases. I think there's so much, but that's where you find a lot of good records.
Okay. Disco Fuentes. Okay.
Disco Fuentes.
Nice.
I found at least 10 copies that I'll put up on the OBC.
Okay, cool.
Stuff from Disco Fuentes.
And they are not that insane expensive, if I'm not mistaken, right?
From 20 to 80.
Oh, that's wonderful. Cool. Yeah.
This is a little bit more expensive. Yeah. It's not crazy.
Cool. But there's no vocals? You don't have a vocal version of that one?
There might be a vocal version on it.
Because I have a 12-inch with a vocal version of that.
Oh, I don't know that.
No, it's an amazing song. It's a cool, very cool, like Balearic style of like dance music.
Okay.
Even if it's cumbia.
Gentlemen, we hit the 2-hour, 20-minute mark. Thomas has a long way home. I think we go into one more song. Then we give a sneak preview on what's up for next week, and then we call it a night.
I have this is one of the records that I play mostly out when I play as a DJ, when I play music from Colombia. So I'll just jump through three tracks for the ending here to hear a little bit of the difference on the album. But I'll start with this.
Pero qué rico camina esa mulata, caballero. Ahora sí, ahora sí. Con tremendo sabor. Sabor a soul.
Is amazing.
Yeah.
Caminando por la calle me encontré
una chica. I love the voice.
It's amazing. I'll jump a little bit to the next track.
Yes.
Another version of Sonny, but I like this. This is my favorite version. I'll come to another track.
Thank you.
Clarinette.
In the album that surprised you all the way through. Yeah. It's
wonderful.
Important.
Wonderful. I'm just thinking the same analog. I must have this record. Damn. Wow, crazy yeah. Good, crazy good. Can you please remember this record when I come to Copenhagen and say, I need this, the last record you played on the South American, I need this, please remember that record.
Can you show the back cover of it? Oh yeah, okay, yeah.
So, okay, can you enlighten us what you just realized? Or will you keep it for yourself?
It's one of those records you will. I think I can find extra copies of.
Okay, cool. No, I just was asked Stunty because can you show the record back of the record? Yeah. Oh, of course. Can you enlighten?
No, yeah. I'm interested in that. Like the bass clarinet on this is insane. Yeah.
It's insane, right?
Yeah. It reminds me of Michel Portal. It's. Yeah, you remember Michael that record I made you buy Desjardins Solo. Yeah. Yep.
Wow, Thomas, thank you for getting us into this record. I think quite some of us are now. Dave, you want this too?
I'm keeping my cards close to my chest. When I go quiet, that's when you got to worry.
Thomas, next week, Thomas and me, we discussed for at least 30 seconds. And then I think we found something where every one of us can contribute a little. Next week, we are getting into soundtracks. Movie scores. I think that is something everybody can talk about, have an opinion, have examples, right?
Yeah.
Dave?
I've got a few.
Absolutely.
You got a few, right?
For sure.
So that is what we will go into next week. And I promise you, as I again had the huge pleasure to listen to the soundtracks Thomas has there, expect amazing stuff. This is one example, an example of one of my all-time favorite movies. It's Wonka Wai's In the Mood for Love, just an example. Thomas has unbelievable movie scores. A lot of them I've never heard of. This one I know, but there will be wonderful stuff. I know that Stunty also has wonderful soundtracks, and yeah. We don't need to talk if Dave has some. I'm 110% certain he has.
And a very interesting and huge area of music. Yeah.
Yeah. And again, the beauty of the soundtrack again is we can go genre-wise everywhere when it comes to soundtracks. Everywhere. Mm-hmm. And we will go in all directions as much as possible, right?
Absolutely.
Tom Ford. Okay. Yeah. Oh, the witch. Yeah.
Cool.
Oh, let's close out, Thomas. Let's close out with this baby. No. The other one. You already shown it. Yes. Come play a tune from that, and with that one we go. People, this is unbelievable what you listen to now. This is something special now. Let's see who realized the first what it is. Listen.
Yeah? I'll just give me 10 seconds to
find. Yeah, of course. Who will realize first what it is? This is special.
Oh, yeah. It's a song. I know what it is. Wait, the Beatles.
Ground control.
Yeah.
Okay. See you next week.
It's bedtime.